Welcome to Freethinker Radio. This is Micah Jackson here at KPFT. Happy to be talking to y'all. Hope you enjoyed Tribute to the Sun. I'm also here with my friend and co-host.
Yo, what's up? It's Derrick Broze. How you guys doing? Happy Monday afternoon. Hope you guys are having a beautiful day where you're at. We're still getting awesome February weather. It's chilly, but not too bad. The sun's out.
The sun is out. It was a beautiful weekend. That's for sure. A lot of stuff been going on. Hope your life's had a few things going on in a good way. And if not, hope this weather, if you're in Houston, helps turn it that way somewhat, because it's amazing and I'm enjoying it. And I went out this weekend to the farmer's market, and that was to the Epicurean market in the Heights. We talked to those people last week, and it was amazing. I've been to it many times. It's always fun. It's great to see people doing things.
And, how was the turnout?
That was the thing. That's what was amazing. I hadn't seen it like it before, and I got there later than I had to a lot of them. And as I pulled up, there were just so many tents, more than ever. One of the vendors for the community was there. Candles of Eden. They were there. It was just packed out. I was really impressed. To see it growing like that gives me a lot of confidence in people doing things. And, you know, I hope it transfers to you with any ideas you might have of your own, you know, be it jewelry, art, music, I don't know, baked goods, whatever. Just do something and get out there in the world. You know, we want to help people like that. So if you're doing something like that, reach out to us at Freethinker Radio on Facebook or the Houston Freethinkers or anything you can figure out. And if you're a musician, we'd love to talk to you at Visionary Noise shows all the time and stuff like that. But anyway, let's talk about stuff. I mean, I talked about the farmer's market, but there's other stuff that happened last week.
Yeah, there was lots of things going on. I participated in a small meeting of individuals, a few different people, involved in various Houston activist communities who are interested in working on developing an idea that I think we've talked about briefly on the show. Maybe future shows we'll talk more about, but the idea of freedom cells and just a specific structure to organize, you know, your activities, not even just with activism, but in general, just the idea, the concept that people work best in groups of 8, 9, or 10 people, and organizing in that fashion and taking on projects. And had a meeting with some people who are interested in that and using that concept to apply it to building communities and homesteading and things like that. So that was pretty cool. And there was all kinds of awesome music happening. And actually, there's something happening tonight for those who may be interested in getting involved with activism here in Houston. Of course, here at Freethinker Radio, Micah and I are just supporters, part of the Houston Freethinker community, and we communicate ideas and news information to you guys.
Events,
and a lot of those events are coming from the Houston Freethinkers community, have been organized by that activist community.
Definitely. So, but what's amazing about the Houston Freethinkers, I have to interrupt, is that it's not just that community. You hear a lot about it from Derrick and I because we're both involved in that, but we're also both involved in other things. But people come to the events because of, you know, the draw that it does have and the interest in ideas. Groups such as the Houston Super you heard about here, you know, but I just want to make sure that everybody knows that there's a lot of events we talk about that go way beyond just what the Houston Freethinkers do. It, because what happens, I think, is people come and they've got ideas and they are able to, you know, directly put them into action and feel somewhat empowered, because I feel like groups like the Houston Freethinkers and even the Farmers Market and For the Community, these are all, as Doria said when she called in from the Heights Epicurean Market, these are all proving grounds for people. And these are proving grounds for ideas. So some people come with an idea. Some people come with a pre-existing structure or something happening. But I think either way, you know, it's great fruit both for the Houston Freethinkers and for the person that comes to the, you know, meetings. But yeah, it's a great place to share your events, don't you think? I mean, lots of people have brought their ideas to like an HFT meeting, Derrick, right?
Yeah, there's all kinds of people that come through and will have their ideas or their what's going on in their community, and that it's a beautiful intersection of ideas and communities. And tonight there will be, if you're on the north side of town, there's actually going to be the North Houston Freethinkers, which is just what it sounds. It's a group of individuals who've been working with the Houston Freethinkers for a time, but reside on the north side of town, maybe northwest, up just outside of downtown, Spring, Tomball, you know, just those areas, maybe Cypress. And if it's more convenient for you to go to that area than to come downtown once a month, you can meet with the North Houston Freethinkers, and they'll be meeting tonight at 7 p.m., I believe. Yeah, so you can find that information on the HoustonFreethinkers.com, which is where most of the events we talk about, not only, again, the Houston Freethinkers events, but other events and other community happenings that we are connected with or that we support. We post their information. We post their stuff on Facebook and on the website. So if you like the Houston Freethinkers on Facebook or Freethinker Radio, you will surely see these events. And, of course, Visionary Noise for all kinds of music. A lot of the music that we play here on our show are, you know, supported and coming through the Visionary Noise channel of the community.
Definitely. That Northside Freethinker meeting, it sounds really interesting. They're going to talk about documentary screenings, Skillshares, info jams, what they have going on up on the north side. And I want to let everybody know that it's going to be located at 6915 Cypresswood Drive in Spring, Texas, 77379. I'll say that address, 6915 Cypresswood Drive, Spring, 77379. So, you know, if you're up there looking for something to do, looking to go talk to a group of people or talk about maybe you wanted to share a movie with people, they got a documentary screenings, maybe you've got some sort of skill, mechanic, jewelry maker, something like that, that you'd like to share and go, you know, find other people that are sharing skills that you might want to learn. And then, you know, maybe you're more on an activist bent and you want to reach more people to let them know what's going on with, various issues we may have. You know, they're going to talk about info jams and just, you know, any way that you can contribute and they can contribute to your concern that they could vibe with, then that's a great thing. So y'all get out there if you're on the north side. Houston's a sprawling city, and you know, it makes sense that we all want to do what's going on, you know, and exciting, you know, maybe you hear about in media or something, but at the same time there's things going on in coffee shops and little venues all around town. So, you know, check out your side of town, get deeper into it, and you know, bring that, you know, back to the biggest, you know, happening that you can find, and you know, you'll advance your crew and yourself as much as you possibly could.
Absolutely, everybody gets to move forward and keep advancing. So check out the North Houston Freethinkers if you're interested in that, and also Wednesday night if you're interested in more connected to the downtown area, or just want to make the main Houston Freethinkers meeting. That'll be Wednesday night at Midtown Bar and Grill at 415 West Gray, 7 p.m. We get started at 7:30-ish exactly. And we'll be going till about 9:30. Come get involved. Put your ideas forth. This is when we set the calendar for the month, what documentaries we're going to screen throughout the month, what places we're going to go to pass out information, what study groups we might form, what discussion groups, what skill shares, what's going to go on at the garden, how can we get involved in different communities, how can we push all of our community projects forward. So if you have ideas on that, please do come out and get involved. Again, that information is at thehoustonfreethinkers.com. So you can check all that out there and stay up with our calendar. We're going to go to a song real quick and get back and talk Houston news, Texas news, national news. And of course, I want to remind you that every Monday from 3 to 5, you can hear us specifically on the HD3 dial here on KPFT Houston. We want to give thanks, of course, to KPFT and support the work that everybody here involved does. And if you support KPFT and you support community-funded commercial free radio, please do go to kpft.org and check out there. You can make a donation if you want to support in that way. Right now they're doing their fund drive to raise money to continue this operation, and KPFT is definitely an important community resource, so support it if you can. And support us, go to Facebook, like Freethinker Radio, like the Houston Freethinkers, like Visionary Noise, and keep checking it out.
Put 90.1 on your FM dial if you're in Houston. I think it's 89.5 in Galveston, 89.7 up in Huntsville, Livingston. Put it on your FM dial on your car. If you got an HD receiver, then definitely put HD3 there. But if not, put 90.1 there, and then stumble over there and explore some of the other programs that they have. If you do that, you may see what a resource this is and be, you know, more persuaded to recognize its value and thus, you know, facilitate their needs, you know, with a donation. And if you can't make a donation, remember there are two ways there that you can help KPFT receive funding without any money coming out of your pocket. If you need to know more about that in detail, please feel free to message the Freethinker page.
Absolutely. Check this out. We're going to be playing more music from for the community, the festival. We keep talking about the upcoming festival, March 18th.
Oh, you made me so excited.
So we're going to, as it gets closer, because we're really only just over a month away, pretty much every show until then, we will be playing music from the artists that you can hear. That these are Houston artists, these are Texas artists, and of course some coming from out of state and even out of the United States. So lots of awesome artists and a mix of genres, because we like to bring not only different people from the community together, but different types of music together, and you know, just bring it all together. Let's all get together and check out various kinds of awesome
together.
Music. Exactly. Music, freedom bring people together. This one is for those who enjoy some heavy music. This is from a younger band called Scavenger. And the guys from this actually are in another band called Low Life that played last time too. They're like, they do hip hop as well. So
I remember them. They played the LCC stage, and yeah. they were quite impressive. I'm surprised that we haven't had them through again. But this one came up a lot faster than the last one. I'm very excited about it. But yeah, let's hear some Scavenger.
Check this out. This is Scavenger. It's called Examine. We'll be right back here on Freethinker Radio, 90.1 KPFT.
Some pretty intense stuff.
Welcome back to Freethinker Radio. You are here with Derrick and Micah. That was Scavenger of Houston, Texas. That song is called Examine off of their EP Feast.
Feast. Yeah, it felt like they feasted on my ears. Anyway.
You can see them, though. I believe we do have them confirmed for the community at number 11 on March 18th and 19th.
Oh, yeah.
At the Last Concert Cafe in Eastdown Warehouse. So, yeah, if you want to hear them, plus much, much, much more music that you'll be hearing throughout this show and the coming weeks, you definitely want to be there on March 18th and 19th.
Yeah, definitely. I think the poster's awesome. It's coming soon, the full glossy awesomeness of the poster. So I am excited about it. The bands keep, you know, more and more acts are being added to the lineup daily, you know, and it just keeps growing. As Derrick said, there's bands, international acts on it. So that's pretty exciting. And it's, you know, spring's going to be coming up, and there's going to be a lot of people that do things there, you know. I guess you could call them merchants. Some of them you could call activists, and some of them you could call musicians, but they're all just people doing things, and that's a good thing about it. So why don't you do something and come out to it, you know? It's going to be fun.
Come on out, yeah.
It's going to be exciting. That's what I got to say. It's going to be exciting.
You know? If you're listening today, and if you have something to say while you hear us talking about music, if you've got music suggestions, or we're talking about these stories we're about to get into, feel free to call in at 713-526-8737, and we will put you on air. Of course, you know, you got to be aware that we are confined to certain restrictions by the FCC.
Yeah, the Central Communications Commission or whatever. You know, we can't really say everything to you that we might say otherwise.
Words.
You know, and, you know, I can't say it that we can't say it because, you know, I really didn't say a lot of them when we were on internet, but some of the musicians sometimes say them, and we have to make sure we navigate around that and play, you know, what they got going on that's super dope without those words.
And be FCC friendly, then please do, you know, share your thoughts and ideas with us.
But if you can't, we'll flush it. So, you know, we'll be sad. We'll see you later and be all cool, but we'll be like, hey, man, you know, that's how it goes. Anyway, but beyond that, man, message us your music, your ideas, anything that you need to get out. We want to share it with the community because we're not here to tell you what to do. We're to share with you what's been going on and what might be coming up so you can make your own choices. Yeah, that's what's up. And thank you, KPFT, for such a brilliant platform to do this from. And we're looking forward to, you know, we're going to go on next week. Did you mention that earlier?
Oh, yeah. Well, let's mention it now. Next Monday morning, so we don't forget. Next Monday morning, if you want to tune into 90.1 KPFT on just the FM1 dial, just the regular standard FM, you can tune in on Monday morning to Open Journal. What's been going on, as I mentioned, they've been having their fund drive, their latest fund drive to raise money for the community radio here. Like I said, listener-supported, commercial-free radio. And they're having the Open Journal program, and they've been doing it a little bit differently, where they have various hosts from the shows come on and talk with Dwayne Bradley, station manager, and Marlo Blue about our show and just, you know, what we have going on. So next Monday from 9 to 9:15-ish or so, we'll be on 90.1 FM on the other dial.
9 o'clock sharp.
9 o'clock sharp. We'll be there. Micah and I will be talking with them for the first portion of Open Journal, and giving a chance to that audience to hear about our show and to know what we're all about and what we're working on. So it should be exciting. So check that out.
Yeah, for sure.
And we'll be on our best behavior.
Yeah, we'll be really good. So yeah, y'all tune in for sure. We want to make sure they get that free thinker a bump on that, you know, numbers of people listening in. Because, you know, we take that important, you know, that's some value that we feel that we're able to bring to the station. We want to make sure it's demonstrated. So if you support us, please check that out. And, you know, we want to share these other great shows with you. You know, that's an interesting show. I really enjoyed being on it before. They've given opportunities for many to come in and talk about what they have going on. And for that, I thank not just the station, but those individuals particularly in that show. And I thank Night Sounds for being able to discover so much great local music and share it with the world, and the same thing with the other music shows on the station, Sweet Nightmares and more. So yeah, it's a great community of people doing things here, and you know, we're not paid as DJs, but the station does require money to keep the lights on, the boards on, the Wi-Fi on, you know, etc. So if you value that, please find a way that you can contribute. And, you know, primarily financially, how many times have you said, I'd pay a quarter not have to listen to this You know, you don't have to hear commercials here, so you're free of that one at least. And not only that, you're hearing community, you know, what's going on in the community, community radio. So there's that. And like we said, if you can't contribute monetarily, please either message us or dig on that kpft.org website and find out about that, because, you know, we don't want to wait till it's too late and then everybody say, what happened to KPFT? You know, it would be great if we had KPFT. Why didn't more people stand up for KPFT? Well, you know, we're not going to let it get to that, are we? So thanks everyone who doesn't let it get to that.
Absolutely. So let's get into some news. You guys what's happening in the city of Houston and around Texas. This is a report from just this past Friday. The Houston police announced high-tech crime mapping tools. From the Associated Press, Houston police are using online technology to make it easier for concerned citizens to track reported crimes in their neighborhoods. The Houston Police Department on Friday announced two new crime mapping tools that will be available on its website. Captain Wyatt Martin says Houston police want to be transparent and get the information out as soon as possible. These updated maps are provided by crimereports.com and raidsonline.com. Citizens can get crime alerts via email and also submit anonymous tips to Crime Stoppers.
So if you're like in, Peaceful Streets Project, you could get these emails sent to you when something's happening near you, and you could go and make sure everything's going good, and you can help the city be safer. Is that what you're telling me?
Yeah, that sounds like some interesting way of looking at that. But absolutely, yeah, if you were aware of this information, then you could make use of it and maybe even put yourself in a position to help the community, you know, if you have
that inclination.
Yeah, if you are so inclined.
But that's kind of strange.
You know, this reminded me, though, and I don't think I mentioned this last week, but we did the Stingray presentation last month about Stingray surveillance and everything we learned in 2015. And what we learned from doing open records requests to the Houston Police Department. Well, I just filed two new open records requests last week, and this was related to two different sources of information. One was related to the license plate reader systems and the company behind that. The other was related to the company behind this other device that some major, some large police departments in the U.S. have had, which is basically this little kind of handheld gun-looking thing that's a radar that can see into your home through the walls and see slight movement.
I remember
slight
talking
movement.
About that a while back.
Yeah, as little as, you know, breathing, basically. You can see that through a wall from more than 500 feet away. So I'm filing to see if HPD has anything on that. Just kind of restructured the way I filed some of the information the first time a little bit.
It's like refining your search query.
Yeah, exactly. Refining my search query and also filing about the HPD aerial surveillance division and these planes that we've been talking about for a while, trying to get more information about what they were about. And last week's show, we talked about how new documents from the ACLU in California actually revealed that the surveillance planes they had flying over there in Anaheim were being shared with local police departments, and they were monitoring all kinds of people there. They sort of bragged about how all the police departments had benefited from their use of having them because they were sharing them with all the jurisdictions around there, including right at Disneyland. So more than likely people at Disneyland had their phones swiped with a Stingray, just showing you the broadened use of these tools and devices. And it's important.
Incursions on your rights.
Exactly.
Sorry, did I say that?
And it's important to recognize you know, the way they're being used. So I'm filing on that, and we'll just keep you updated as that evolves.
Yeah, definitely. I think Derrick will keep us updated about that. No. Notice it along the way, because you know, I just don't know where you draw the line after a while with all this stuff. You know, you can turn away because it happens to catch a bad guy every once in a while, or you can just go, wait a minute, you know, I mean, I get that you gotta catch a bad guy, but do you have to be a bad guy to catch a bad guy? Do you have to like violate all these people's civil liberties, human rights, constitutional rights, or whatever you want to call them, to do this? And if so, what kind of system is that? And is that the system you want to back up? I really don't know, but I feel like that's what these things point out, whether it's the Stingrays or the TSA, you know, X-ray in you and stuff like that, you know. So I think that's an interesting point, and I know I'm not alone on this, that, you know, there are other people out there that have these concerns. So, you know, How you know, at what point do we go ahead and say, okay, a little bit of violation, a little bit of violence is okay, because every once in a while you got to do it to catch a bad guy.
Yeah, it seems like that's the way it's become, where the you know, with the commonly accepted, the norm of what violence is allowable has reached, I'd say, disturbing levels. And also, I think it's because maybe the majority of the population doesn't question the everyday violence that exists in government itself through, you know, taxation. Like, you know, you could say a statement like taxation is theft, or that you think that government itself is violence. And someone might think that that sounds extreme, or yeah, just extreme or radical. But when you think about it, and ideas like taxation or government services or government itself, I don't know when. I mean, are you voluntarily paying your taxes? And if you, you know, choose not to pay your taxes, are you aware? And I think most people are aware of consequences of that, which include the IRS coming after you, bothering you, eventually somebody putting you in a cage and locking you up. So that all comes with the threat of force. You know, these things are backed up with force, the government action itself and these ideas. So I feel like because of that, and because we see these things on an everyday basis and people don't recognize that, that sort of violence is accepted or sort of agreed upon.
Here's the typical response, right? But Derrick, you use the roads, you use the civil services that the government provides you, and therefore you should have to pay for those services.
Or I should get out.
But doesn't, if you pay for something, aren't you a customer? And if you're a customer, isn't that a voluntary agreement? And are, yeah, your taxes voluntary?
I don't think the taxes are voluntary, and I don't think I ever agreed.
That's so confusing.
Made an agreement with the U.S. government. And if I did, I rescind such agreement.
Yes, I cancel this. I nullify it.
I nullify it as of this moment, and you are all witness. I nullify my, if any such contract ever existed, it has been nullified between me and the U.S. government.
Oh, man.
And
on the local news.
So this one, look, this one is, it's sort of related. The Houston Joint Terrorism Task Force addresses security threats, challenges for area. The Houston Joint Terrorism Task Force, including agents from the FBI and other federal and local law enforcement, met with the press and U.S. Senator John Cornyn on Friday to discuss security across the Houston area. Challenges facing the Houston region, including those surrounding the Port of Houston and Super Bowl 51, were discussed, because I guess Houston is going to be the next city to host the Super Bowl next year. ABC reporter Jeff Elling noted this morning that this was basically an opportunity for Cornyn to sit down with local officials to find out what they were doing and if they needed any help from Washington.
I bet any time he asked local officials, they'd take an opportunity to sit down with the senator.
He sat down with County Judge Ed Emmett, Sheriff Ron Hickman, as well as members of the local FBI Terrorism Task Force. The officials noted Texas has the largest Muslim population of any state in the nation. That's an interesting thing to note. They added the threats have changed a lot since the last time Houston hosted a Super Bowl, noting that homegrown terror suspects are a huge concern. See, I hate when they start talking like this. This freaks me out. They're coming to the Super Bowl here. They're going to be talking all this paranoia.
Yeah, remember what we say? I said at that TSA thing, they said not unless it's a nationally significant event. And I said, what's that? Like the football game, the 4th of July? You know, we said the 4th of July, and we talked about how Amtrak got...
So what Mike is referring to is...
Oops, sorry.
The program known as Bus Safe that the TSA and Department of Homeland Security and all the federal officials launched in 2012. They started with Houston as a pilot city, and they started using the TSA on the local bus, the Metro bus line, and saying that everybody would be subject to random searches, drug sniffing dogs, you know, going through their stuff and all kinds of things.
That doesn't sound right.
We made a big stink about it over several weeks. A lot of people got together, organized, and had the program ended. But yes, when they did end the program, they, you know, said it with one caveat that, you know, the TSA, we would not bring them back unless there was some sort of emergency.
Nationally significant event.
Yeah. Yep. And so obviously they're talking about this. Now you're making my little curiosity go off. Because see, I wonder, I'm like, are there any transcripts of this meeting? Did this meeting discuss the need for TSA? Because this would be the point where they would be discussing at the Houston Joint Terrorism Task Force, local officials and the FBI, they would probably be like, hey, you know what? This is probably a good time to bring the TSA back.
We need to scan these people.
And
you know, we got more terrorists than ever. We got more Muslims. Therefore, there must be more terrorists that would come to the Super Bowl. And, you know, therefore, we need to scan everything.
It says, they added, threats have changed a lot since last time Houston hosted Super Bowl. Homegrown terror suspects are a huge concern today. Part of the challenge of keeping everyone safe is to reach out to the local Muslim community and make sure things are reported to law enforcement.
What kind of things?
Local officials say they are doing that, and Senators says it's an important effort because of the potential terror targets in Houston. He added that cooperation with local, state, and federal agencies is needed to combat the threats. Cornyn said, I'm very proud of what Harris County has done with the city and state and federal partners to try and deal with both the threat of terrorist attacks as well as hurricanes and natural disasters. As for the Super Bowl, local officials say there is a team at Super Bowl 51 monitoring the security plan out there and will have a report on what needs to be changed in Houston once that team gets back.
When are we going to get that report up in here?
Interesting. I want to see if there's any more information.
How do we get
online.
A copy of that? How do we get that memo?
I'm going to keep this one here to look at later.
That sounds like good research.
To see what sounds other amazing. Things were discussed in this meeting.
They'll probably just be like, okay, well, but it'll let you know what sort of things they want to do. And across the, you know, our listeners' audience, this is the type of things that we do. You know, you read the news and you see some of these things that happen and you see, you know, the parallels and the things that can happen. And you know that it's something worth reporting on, you know, and if nothing happens, then you got a dead lead. But that's just, you know, locally, if you're an activist, it's a good way to start getting involved in what's going on, or at least knowing on a different level than your everyday individual that just doesn't even know. Don't even care.
Don't even care.
Back page of the news.
Don't even know you're uninformed. Let's go to a song.
Songs are good.
I got this.
At least all the ones you're going to hear here.
This is a different one. This is from Crazed Music, who will also, again, be at For the Community number 11. On, when is it, Micah?
March 18th and 19th, Friday and Saturday, so you don't even got to worry about it. Just come on down and have a good time. You know, you're RSVP, we got it. You know, go ahead, take that Facebook event, share it, invite all your friends so that even more people turn out and enjoy it, you know, and check that lineup out.
And I know we got friends who are listening from outside of Houston, and we've been successful the past couple ones. I've got like Nick from the Anti-Media from San Diego and John Vibes from Maryland. We had several friends of guys from the Free Thought Project come from California. We've had bands come from out of town, out of state. So if you're listening and you keep seeing us post on Facebook or talking about this, you know, what is this festival? It's not just, you know, this is beyond a festival you've ever experienced. And I know there's a lot of amazing, powerful festivals out there, but this is really, you know, it is what it sounds like, what it is named. It is for the community, from the community, poetry, music, art, tons of music, tons of new ideas, great people, all kinds of people coming together and sharing their ideas and sharing their, you know, themselves and bring it together in a powerful way. So you don't want to miss it, and you don't want to miss this music. So please do check out For the Community.
You know what Derek's saying is true.
11.
It is a lot of people doing things. And I think that, you know, your support means the world. You know, if you want to empower people doing things, then invite them to this event. We don't, you know, there's no cover. You know, we struggle to make sure that the venues have been taken care of, you know, the sound men, et cetera, through the vendors' contributions to that. And without that, you know, the event really won't go on. So it keeps growing and keeps growing, and we certainly would be glad to, you know, work with you to host you at the event. So message us, whether you're a band, a vendor, or just someone who wants to reach out. And if you're someone who wants to support this, please, you know, go to Visionary Noise, go to Houston Free Thinkers, share that poster, invite all your friends, because it is exactly what it says it is. It's free, always free.
We'll be right back. You're listening to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT.
Yeah, crazy music. That guy's tremendous. There's going to be some interesting producers at For the Community. Falcons. Oh. I can't say it, but I'll spell it, because he doesn't say it. It's just missing letters. So go see Falcon, F-C-K-E-R, and, you know, others. So we, you know, he it's really, that's how you find him. And we'll be playing some Falcon, F-C-K-E-R, later, because we're really stoked to have him on board.
And, yeah, we're excited to work with everybody.
There's so many great, great acts that come through. You know, Derrick mentioned that we have international acts and a lot of local acts because we want to use the biggest draw that we can get in order to help accent the local acts that are doing things. That's what the whole nature of this is. And we've seen a lot of great acts go on and come back and play for the communities and stuff. So we're excited about it, needless to say. And we're going to get on into some other stuff, though, because you'll hear about it from now till March. Oh gosh, you'll hear about it till
you'll hear
April,
it
May.
Weeks. So this one's interesting. This is not a traditional news story, I think, but again, this is one I definitely would enjoy to hear some different opinions on. 713-526-8737 to call into Freethinker Radio. This says a Texas appeals court ruled on Friday that the Texas Film Commission acted within its authority when it decided, after the release of the film Machete, to deny its producers state incentive funds because of the movie's negative portrayal of Texas. So let's unpack that. You know that movie Machete with that one guy?
I didn't see it, man.
I never saw it either, but I remember there being a big, like, there was an uproar from some crowds of people. It was a 2010 Robert Rodriguez film starring Danny Trejo as a former Mexican federale turned vigilante who accepts a hit contract from a corrupt Texas state senator before being used as a pawn in the senator's hardline immigration policies. Filmed in and around Austin, the movie was theoretically eligible for a financial grant from the state's film commission to partially reimburse costs, but the claim has been denied upon a final review, Producers argued that they would have not filmed in Texas and spent about $8 million in production wages and other expenses in the state had the commission not granted initial approval after reading the film script. But in an opinion written on Friday by Justice Scott Field, the appeals court said the commission has the right to change its mind once it watches a completed project. Basically, so they, you know, revoked this grant that they would give for films. And the reason they revoked it is because they said that they portrayed Texas unfavorably in the movie. It says the content reviewable at the post-production stage is more comprehensive and includes not just the written words of the script, but also the manner in which the words were spoken and the locations and costumes used by actors delivering the lines of script. The decision reignites a long-running debate over the role of content judgment in the film incentives award process. Some filmmakers have argued that the clause which allow the commission to deny incentives after films come out if they contain, quote, content that portray Texas or Texans in a negative fashion is akin to censorship. Some lawmakers in recent years have actually...
Yeah, it's basically saying you're going to pay more...
If you don't criticize
Texas. Yeah, it kind of messed up because nobody should get the funding at all. But what's happening is the people that say the...
It's like favoritism.
Yeah.
So it says in recent years, some lawmakers have proposed scrapping the film incentives program altogether, describing it as corporate welfare. And last year's legislative session, lawmakers cut the program's two-year budget by more than 66% from $95 million to $32 million for 2016 to 17. That's still a lot of money.
Local films are booming here. We got more of a film scene in Houston than in ever, you know? Maybe because people are just more empowered in getting out to do things. Maybe it's right. Maybe Robert Rodriguez doesn't need $8 million to get a discount, whether, you know, I don't know. I mean, I really don't. I wish I'd seen the film. I mean, I'd seen other movies of his, and they just seem like movies, you know what I'm saying? Nothing good, nothing bad, particularly in my mind, but...
So this interesting part says the program was a priority for former Governor Rick Perry as part of his attempts to bring business to the state and foster economic development.
Yeah.
So he says the Texas Moving Image Industry Incentive Program was created in 2005 in an effort to attract more filmmakers to use the state as a location. So interesting here. I don't know. Like, I think I would agree with the whole corporate welfare thing, and just that, like you said, that I don't know if the state really, what is the benefit? I guess it's just you're thinking, okay, well, if we bring filmmakers into our city, the government officials...
They're going to stay for 6 months.
They're going to come here. They're going to bring media attention on our town, our city.
They're going to rent hotel rooms.
They're
going to
use services. And so in exchange for that, whatever we gain, we'll give them a little rebate and, you know, give them some money back, promise them some money back to incentivize them to come to our city. But I feel like, yeah, those people will come there.
How much? $8 million?
$8 million is what they're
asking. I don't know, man. What if they just gave $8 million to the businesses they wanted to, you know, do better?
Yeah, exactly. I feel, I mean,
they already had to get that money from the businesses.
If you
want to
make a movie or a product,
Texas,
you have to assume that risk. You know, it's kind of how I feel like, you know, I think that there's, communities can come up with ways to, you know, if we had a community and we're like, we have a piece of land and it's beautiful, it looks great, it would look great in a movie, so we're going to tell people, hey, come film a movie here and, you know, we'll give you these benefits here or whatever, we'll charge you cheaper than whatever, you know, we make an arrangement. I don't see anything wrong with that, but then when it comes to this, when you take that from just on a communal level to a larger centralized force like government, and government's taking from the people, like we talked about taxation, and then using that money to, you know, fund film industries or whatever they want. Maybe some people don't want their money to go to the film industry. Maybe people are against movies or they don't want to work with, you know, they don't support.
It's definitely far from their hands.
So they have no control over where it's going. And I don't know. It just seems like it becomes problematic once the government starts giving people money. And
well, you know, somebody's got to pick someone somehow, and they make these judgments with other people's money.
What you doing with my money?
Judging. Buying my CDs and hooking up the movies I want to. What you doing not giving?
Dang, government just takes like that.
Yeah, all kinds of crazy things going on. There's been a lot of shooting going on in and around Houston and Texas.
Stories like that. I was trying not to get, really pay attention, but you can't really ignore
them. Nothing too weird, but there's been a rage of it lately, you know? And there's these sort of things where you just don't know much about it, you know? Like where it looks like, you know, two robbers go into a gas station, you know, and loot them. Officer jumps up and nails them. Bam! You know, it's like, whoa, well, you know, so I don't know what to say. You know, they don't say anything about the people, you know, so, you know, anyway, who knows? Maybe they needed to be popped. I don't know. I really don't. But this is a weird one that came from Austin. I guess that's relatively local. They shot a man who was, they got basically a call from some weirdo in a neighborhood, you know, and the police chief of staff told reporters that the man died at hospital after being shot Monday morning. That was, you know, just today. He basically was naked in the street, and he charged a police officer, so he got popped. I don't know. What do you think? Call in today, 713-526-8737. What justifies a pop?
Yeah, and also, you know, we have to remind ourselves that, like, just, you know, those simple lines like this, like this person, you know, ran after a cop and was shot. Yeah, that's, it's really easy to write.
Couldn't
that
shoot the naked man in the knee, though.
Well, how many times, though, have we, you know, seen, we've heard cops say that he was running after me, he had this or that, and then later a video gets released and the person got their hands in the air or something like that.
So, yeah, he could have had a shank hidden somewhere.
It's important to be critical of these reports, I guess, and just keep your eyes and ears peeled as information
develops. Yeah, it's just stuff going by, you know. Some things deserve a little bit closer look, and some things are just like, huh, okay. But, you know, that's part of our job here is to just go through these things, and some of them we say, hey, here's a thing that went by because, you know, it's what happened.
Absolutely. This one is also related to Texas in general, and it may relate to wherever you're living, whether you're here in the Lone Star State or not, because I think that other states have adopted this program if it started in Texas or wherever it started. But it's this surcharge driver responsibility program is what they call it.
Well, we certainly got that here.
So this came out at the end of January, just a couple weeks ago. It says lawmakers compare driver surcharge program to debtor's prison from the Texas Tribune. State senators expressed bipartisan disapproval Wednesday of an unpopular program that levies large surcharges on drivers for traffic offenses, with several calling for broad changes or for scrapping the program entirely. The driver responsibility program, created in 2003 to address a budget shortfall, so they can't keep a budget, so they have to tax you.
Yeah, it wasn't the motivation to
come with all this stuff to make sure that they can make up their budget. Like, it's like, okay, well, let's think of a bunch of different
ways.
So
you can imagine that driver responsibility was really not the highest thing on the priority.
So it says to come up with budget shortfall and promote more responsible driving, mm-hmm, requires drivers convicted of certain traffic offenses, such as speeding and driving while intoxicated, to pay additional annual surcharges on top of any court fines and criminal penalties to maintain their driver's license. Nearly 1.3 million drivers now have invalid licenses, according to the Texas Criminal Justice Coalition. This is an interesting thing, is when I started to look into this, because I am one of those 1.3 million people, because
of
this
million
program, because I refused to pay them this $3,000 for something that I, you know, a DWI had back in 2008. I mean, that's just a whole other topic. But it's apparently there's a lot of people who feel the same way in the state that...
Well, it's on even, you know, it's not just on DWIs.
No, it's like, it's everything.
I had an infinity of traffic tickets, basically.
Speeding tickets, anything.
Yeah. I got out of all the tickets, but I didn't get out of the surcharges that they had, like, from the license suspension thing. And it was annoying as all get out.
They can basically suspend your license for any sort of violation now. So it's like, if you haven't, you get...
But once they do that, it doesn't matter if you're innocent of it. You still end up getting stuck with the surcharge.
You get ticketed for a speeding offense or whatever, and then, you know, you go to court and you got to pay a fine or whatever, and maybe take a driver's course. But then on top of that, they're like, oh yeah, then you got to pay this extra thing, and if you don't pay this, then your license is automatically suspended, and if you don't pay it after a while, it can turn into a warrant or whatever.
And then
you got to pay all these extra. So yeah, it's just a way to keep people in there, and many people have complained about it. It says some lawmakers have previously defended the program because it sends millions of dollars each year to hospitals and trauma centers.
But what about the person that says a drunk driver needs to be taught a lesson and not be let right back on the road again, and this helps to do
just pay money
like that?
While State Senator Lois Calkhurst of Brenham, Texas, raised those concerns on this Senate Transportation Committee hearing, others on the committee suggested seeking alternative sources of funding, as critics spoke of the hardship the program's penalties cause, such as lost job and stints in jail. Yep. Democratic Senators Sylvia Garcia and Rodney Ellis of Houston made comparisons between the program and payday loan scam. It just makes poor people poor, Garcia said. State Senator Don Huffines of Dallas likened the program to debtor's prison, a comparison that other senators returned to throughout the hearing. Obviously, it doesn't bother a rich person, somebody who has the ability to pay, but we're creating a permanent underclass. So I think this is a bigger problem than people might realize.
Yeah.
You know?
We don't need any sort of incentivization of that sort of thing going on. There's enough of it happen naturally that we don't need to, you know, use the middle class to make the, you know, poorer class poorer like that. You know, it's kind of wrong. I don't know. It's like one of those things where they try to throw a number at it. Like, if you pay this much, you will have learned.
Yeah, I mean, it's silly. Like I said, this is something that directly has affected me because I just don't feel like, you know, that I feel like I already did. I already took all the classes, paid the fines, did jail time, whatever else I was supposed to do, and this is just some other way to be.
Yeah, because you're told that's why you're being reformed.
Now you got to do this thing just to get this little piece of thing, and we're also going to not allow you to travel or fly without this thing. You know, so it's you know, they control the whole, you know, both ends of it. It says during last year's legislative session, the Senate approved a proposal to weaken the program. The measure died in the House. However, another bill passed that reduced some of the surcharges. Senators' comments at Wednesday's hearing suggested a strong interest in either dramatically reforming the program or scrapping it entirely when the legislature meets again next year.
So if doing stuff as an activist on the local state level is something that you want to do, here's a chance to, you know, kind of Robin Hood it for some people and make them stop, you know, exploiting the poor the most, you know, because they're the ones who are hurt by this the most. Look, if somebody's already had to go to jail, had to go through the classes and all that stuff to have their license given back, why does an extra $3,000 make any world of difference, you know? And if you're one of those 1.3 million and you're not on this on a local level, if you believe in voting at all or even pressuring your so-called representatives, then you I don't know what to say to you, man. You should be making a phone call, at least let them know, man. Annoy them, email them. You can email all those people.
Yeah, there's definitely, like it mentions,
you're taking money, and you know it's wrong.
It seems like this is one of the organizations fighting this, Texas Criminal Justice Coalition, so you might want to approach them if you're interested in getting involved with this fight. Look, this one of the ladies from a policy attorney from the Texas Criminal Justice Coalition says she describes one case she worked on in which a single DWI for a 67-year-old woman eventually escalated into $25,000 in fines and several jail stays.
Yeah, see, that's horrible. You know, it's like criminalizing like someone that did have like a oops. You know, people have oops moments, and we are supposed to be a free country. And I think one part of it is you could just, you know, kind of start over. You pay your penalty. You know, you go to jail, you take your classes, you do whatever you have to do. You pay the normal charge to get your license back and all that. And you go on about your way, you know, and after you do things a few times, then we know there's a problem. But really, to just assume that people have to pay this huge amount is a bit much. You know, I feel like in a sense, it's not that big of an issue. But, you know, when you look at the numbers on it, it is a big issue. And for a lot of people, it probably especially in some broke rural areas where they need their vehicle to survive or whatever, it's a serious day-to-day life
thing. Or just
thing.
Living paycheck to paycheck and can't pay
anywhere.
These things.
Yeah, it's a serious life thing. I mean, in fact, I quit driving, I'll say this, just from the traffic tickets and the surcharges, I quit driving for a while. I rode a bike for years and years and years and years, you know? And, you know, finally I was able to deal with the legal aspect of the tickets in a way that was, you know,
satisfactory.
Yeah, definitely. So the state got theirs and I got mine, and mine wasn't too bad, but I went to go get my license and they said, well, you have these surcharges, and it was, you know, just all traffic stuff that had added up. And the funny thing is, most of it I'd already, if I hadn't been found not guilty, I think I was found not guilty on almost everything there. I had I had like 11 surcharges of blank dollars, because there's a small one on everything, like $25 or $35, you know. And it was horrible, because basically what happens, I went to jail, I got picked up for no tail light on my bicycle, and was immediately taken to jail for my traffic warrants from adding up all this time. And when I went, I got out on a Sunday, and because of course the officer didn't want to go down and you know, represent on 7-year-old case or something. And you know, the funny thing is, on most of it I was innocent anyway, except maybe not wearing my seatbelt. And that was interesting. But yeah, so after everything, and here I was innocent, you know, not found guilty of it, bam, surcharges. And in your case, you know, there's something that you are guilty of. You did your time. You did what everybody says is the penalty. And bam, there's this new penalty that they put in to help make budget. And let's go ahead, because, you know, anybody who's been through Logic 101 knows that if you can just put this conjunct between something and say it's so, then it's automatically so. Just, yeah, right.
It says, the report here says that New York and New Jersey are the only remaining states with a similarly structured driver responsibility program. Virginia repealed its version, and Michigan is currently phasing it out.
Yeah, we shouldn't be backwards here in Texas. We got the space station, we got the oil things, we got the light rail. Man, get with the program.
Senator Bob Hall of Edgewood, Texas, says, we're one of the few states that still has this draconian system going. I think we
draconian.
Need to take a look at what other states have done that has had success. And Bill Hammond, CEO of the Texas Association of Business, said he was troubled by the way the program forces people who need to drive to work to risk exorbitant penalties. It's failed public policy. It's not working.
Failed.
He describes it as double jeopardy. In order for people to eat, they have to work. In order for them to work, they have to drive in most cases. So it's just...
Yeah, they're perpetually punished for the same crime.
It's a cascading situation that gets worse and worse and doesn't create the behavior it's intended to create. And you even have a judge of Harris County Criminal Court speaking out saying, I don't know if I've seen a public law with such dire unintended consequences. So the good thing, it sounds like, is that more and more people are recognizing that this is ridiculous, and I might eventually not have to worry about this, because it's I'm one of those 1.3 million people who aren't going to pay them for this silly program.
It'd be nice if it was gone, because, you know, it'd be cool if you could drive.
Yeah, I might still drive.
You might nullify that, huh? You never know. Got to keep your eye on.
Well, I guess it's the top of the hour. We're going to play some more music, and you're listening to Freethinker Radio here on KPFT Houston on the HD3 dial. Want to remind you to support KPFT. Go to kpft.org. Check out the rest of the shows. Check out the schedule on both the FM and the HD dial, and you can see the archives too. If you miss our shows, of course, the archives are always at Houston Freethinkers YouTube channel, excuse me. And all our upcoming events and details can be found at thehoustonfreethinkers.com. I'm not sure who we got in the bottom, but
we're gonna
find out. So we'll press play and find out. Enjoy this. Welcome back to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston on the HD3 dial. That was
Bell Ringer, an interesting band, new band here in Texas, featuring Mark Dutrum of the Melvins and other acts and founded music labels and such. They came through, played Fitzgerald's with Ganesha, and they've come through a show of ours before, and I look forward to them coming back. I'm not exactly sure when their next date here is, but you'll hear more about it as we get closer, I'm sure. So if you're into that sort of thing, check out Bell Ringer for sure. Always glad to bring music to people. Some shows you'll hear more, some shows you'll hear less. You know, that's just part of what we do here.
Absolutely. So let's get now into the national, international news for the second half of our show today. And of course, what we try to do every week when we post our archives on the HoustonFreethinkers.com, all the links of the stories we're going over are found in the show notes. So we've been getting better at keeping track of those and sharing them so you can find them there. And of course, we usually post all the same links on the Freethinker Radio Facebook page or the Houston Freethinkers Facebook page. So keep up with our networks and you should be informed of all the stuff we're talking about. So you can do your own research, make up your own mind. Don't assume that, you know, our opinions are the same that you should carry. Make up your own thoughts and mind based on your research. So keep up with those links. One important story that I know that we absolutely have to mention out of many, many important things going on in the past week or so is the fact that on Thursday, the Trans-Pacific Partnership was signed in Auckland, New Zealand. The TPP, as it is known, is, of course, the controversial trade agreement that has been hammered out in secret for the last 3-4 years or so, involving 12 nations that make up the majority of the world's economy. These include Australia, Brunei, Canada, Chile, Japan, Malaysia, Mexico, New Zealand, Peru, Singapore, the United States, and Vietnam. So now that the TPP has officially been signed in Auckland, it now has 2 years to be ratified within the individual nations. And of course, within these nations, the process is a little bit different. But in the United States, both the House and the Senate have to vote to approve the TPP. And of course, some of you may remember that back in June of last year, 2015, Obama signed into law the so-called Fast Track Bill, which set the stage for approval of the TPP. Fast Track essentially means that Congress only has the ability to vote yes or no and cannot alter the provisions of the trade deal. This, you know, basically the way they pitch it is that, you know, if we have all the senators and congressmen changing the deal after the international body has met, which is, you know, really when you think about it, it's not the presidents from these nations going to meet to hammer out this agreement. These are trade ministers, just some other bureaucrat from each nation coming and
some appointee
making, you know, yeah, somebody you didn't vote for. That really shows you the power of the, you know, the lack of power that the president has. I'm sure he has some, maybe, hey, get us these, score us these points or whatever. But ultimately, it's the trade ministers working out these agreements with influence from all sorts of corporate entities and, you know, government, looking at it from the government's point of view, operating in secret. And then they agree on certain portions and they bring it back to here to the United States. And your representatives, the people that you supposedly elect that are supposed to represent your viewpoints, can only say yes or no. You know, so if they like some of it but they don't like other parts, they just have to make a choice, yes or no. And that vote may come after the 2016 election. It was recently reported that Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell wanted the agreement to possibly wait till later because they know that it's unpopular, and they said maybe even push it on to the next president to be approved because they have up to 2 years. And the article that we're looking at here from Truth in Media, it also talks about the fact that a number of organizations have pointed out the flaws in this agreement, from privacy concerns, intellectual property concerns, to everything related to health, to medicine, to GMOs. The fact that I think probably the most egregious part is the ISDS, the Investor State Dispute Settlement Mechanism, which basically gives corporations loopholes to escape accountability and empower these international bodies. If a corporation is found guilty of some crime in the United States or one of these countries, or of some, you know, illegal trade deal or what have you, they can appeal to an international body and get that decision overturned. So obviously you can see the problems in that. And this is just, you know, it's going to be a big deal. And a recent report found that it's going to lead to 500,000 jobs lost, not the increase in jobs that they are promoting. And although there was maybe scattered protests in the United States, I know I saw at least four or five cities organized for something called Flush the TPP. In Auckland, there was literally tens and thousands of people outside of the building where they were signing it.
People took an interest in their life.
They did, and you can see the pictures here in the article. If you go search Auckland TPPA, Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, TPPA walkaway, hashtags, those, you'll find pictures of that. There was also even one lady chose to throw a dildo at one of the trade ministers because
he deserved it.
He said that's for screwing us out of our sovereignty is what she was yelling as she was dragged away and arrested. But it was one of the trade ministers. He's sitting there giving a conference, and quite hilariously, you see this dildo smack him in the face, and he's just stunned. And you know, immediately, of course, the lady is dragged away. And you know, maybe it's not your form of protest, but there are some angry people out there, and that
there's some humor to it.
There, and that clip has been played all over the internet, and you know, it's been interesting to say the least. But hopefully, that sparks a trend. You know, we had the shoe throwers a few years back, and I'm not advocating throwing shoes, but perhaps
you can also gift the people who make the right decisions. You know, that's the flip side of it. Yeah. I like that. And, you know, I'm just throwing it out there because that's not an often used tactic. But it throws a wrench in the system because, say, it's this bill you're talking about with the Texas legislature to get rid of the surcharges. You know, the guys who vote for it, they get flowers or whatever the next day, you know, and all this stuff's happening there at the event, you know, in the Senate. You know, they're bringing these things into their offices and filling the place with this, and the bad guys don't get no love. Anyway, that's how it goes. It make them sad. And they get, like, reprimanded by the community because, after all, what else are we going to do? Because they don't listen to our vote. They don't care about our money except to take it. And we're lucky they let us keep whatever they do. That's how they see it.
What else you got now, Micah?
All kinds of stuff going on. I thought it was kind of interesting that... Well, I'm just going to move on anyway. That wasn't that interesting. I lied. That federal judge with the ineptitude thing was kind of interesting because he's got a history of bringing up such things. It's kind of was local, but it's a national thing because the U.S. District Judge Lynn N. Huge said if the, quote, pretentious prosecutors visiting from D.C. knew what they were doing or had the humility to ask for help from their Houston-based counterparts, they would have known how to get certain manuscripts about a case, and that case happens to be this case that they're pursuing against Omar Faraj Sarid al-Hardin, a man who is accused of trying to join the ISIS terrorist group. Yeah.
Interesting.
He came to Houston in 2009. He was arrested in January. And so, you know, the local federal judge who was appointed back in 85 is basically taking the government to task in a little bit of a way because he's actually, you know, this sounds like no big deal, but he's issued this order from the Southern District of Texas, an order of ineptitude, you know. So, you know, that's, you know, the way it starts out here. You've got accused terrorist, zero, United States government minus 0.5. I don't know, you know, and stay tuned. But, you know, there's a lot more than that going on in the world for sure. The U.S. is expected to increase defense spending by 400% in Eastern Europe. Jeez. You know. Yeah, because, you know, this, we're talking all about Russia all the time, you know, and we're reinforcing our posture in Europe to support our NATO allies in the face of Russia's aggression. That's what... Ashton Carter, the defense secretary, said. So expect more money to be spent meddling in more stuff than ever.
And you know, see, this is why, you know, no matter where you stand on the various political spectrum, and if you support any of the range of candidates that are out there from any of the parties, not just the two parties, but, you know, all of the parties out there, I think that I just lost my train of thought.
That parties rule except for the political parties, who then also make you pay for the country to host their conventions and do other criminal, horrible things. But look, here we have this increase in defense spending, but 400% in Eastern Europe because we're concerned about Russian aggression. Are we really concerned about Russian aggression against the United States of America?
I remember what I was going to say.
And our NATO allies, really? You're going to forget. I'm going to keep
talking. Okay, so here it is. Basically, what I'm saying is no matter where you stand on the political spectrum, when people hear about the problems facing America, we can all generally agree that You know, whether you're concerned about economic inequalities or the wars or government intrusion, etc., I think we can all recognize that. So whatever they're spending now, they're going to increase that by 400%. I'm sure the number's already up to the trillions. And just imagine if the government is stealing from you through taxation, which is what I would consider theft. Maybe you don't, but let's even say it's not for the sake of this
argument. Let's just say you don't want war.
That 400% of increase, you know, and whatever's already there. I know I've seen some memes going around for whatever it's worth, but I'm sure the math is something similar. Like, oh, this one F-35 could pay for so much college for this many students, et cetera.
Even less than that, the Tomahawk 400%? Missiles that's just thrown away, you know, just
exactly.
in every practice.
I mean, so what is 400% increase going to do? Like, how many, 400%. You know, if we're talking about using the force of government and that money, you know, in the ideal way of, okay, we all pay taxes, right? So let's use it for the benefit of the people. Obviously, a 400% increase in military spending is not going to be for the benefit of the people of this country or any other country.
Well, they say here it's reinforcing our posture.
They're keeping us safe.
We're posing.
They're keeping us safe.
It's for our pose. It costs that much extra for this posture in Europe in order to support our NATO allies in the face of Russia's aggression. I don't know, you know. I don't know what we're going to do. If we got to keep amping it up 400% to keep posing because we're worried about Russian aggression, why are we going to do this? I mean, like, really, like, Europe can't do it themselves. Europe can't defend themselves against Russia. Is that what we're really saying here? And if they can't, is that our problem? And if so, why? Call in at 713-526-8737 if you have the answers to these or any other questions that we haven't failed to ask or have failed to ask. We'd like to hear that.
Absolutely. I got another story here that relates to banks, the banksters, and the 2008 financial crisis that many are still feeling the effects of course, trillions of dollars lost. Many people lost homes, lost businesses, life savings, etc.
And it's followed up by trillions stolen.
Trillions are stolen, banks bailed out. You know, I mean, this is just all of these, this money, the government taking money from the people to redistribute it to the same people who's
the rich.
Know, who
failed,
took it from the people who failed and couldn't legitimately run their business. That is what you call corporate welfare and, you know,
the worst
the
stripe.
Failures of government intervention and funding. But now here is just to add more insult to injury.
Unintended consequences.
There is the bank HSBC, which is, of course, based out of London, and fined $470 million for 2008 financial crisis. So, you know, you see that number, and to the average person who's just trying to make it through another day, $470 million sounds like a lot of money. But when you really take into consideration all the money that was lost over that period of time, which, according to one estimate back in 2012 from the Treasury Department, and this is from the government, so we can expect the numbers to probably be lower than what they actually were, they were estimating that total household wealth lost was $19.2 trillion. So $19.2 trillion, if that's, you know,
just
one estimate,
dried up.
$470 million doesn't even touch that. You know, and this is, of course, just from
that's not even counting, like, TARP bailout, how much this bank may have got. If you got, like, I don't know, a bailout of $100 million, do you think, what, how many years later is it now, you could reproduce this much money and, you know?
So, look, let me read you the specifics of this, because in some way, I mean, I can't really, I'm like, okay, well, that sounds interesting. Maybe some people get their money back, but still, it's just a drop in the bucket of how much wealth was actually stolen and continues to be stolen. I mean, there's a couple other important points, but under this agreement, HSBC must reduce mortgage rate interest rates as well as the principal on mortgages for homeowners who are at risk of default. HSBC must also improve their standards for handling service loans and foreclosures. The hope is that these new practices will discourage the actions that led to the financial crisis that started in 2007 due to the banks like HSBC knowingly giving out bad loans. So it says the U.S. government and the individual states involved in this deal will receive $100 million in an escrow fund that will make payments to people who lost their homes due to foreclosure between 2008 and 2012. So, of course, the U.S. head of Justice Department, they promoted this as, you know, this is part of our ongoing effort to address the root causes of the financial crisis. But despite their statements, you got to remember that there's only one person who's ever been put in prison for this largest theft in recent memory. And, you know, you can be assured that one person wasn't single-handedly responsible for this. And the rest of the people that were held responsible have all been considered small fish, just, you know, small players in this international game of banking and theft. We had Public Citizen, a watchdog and advocacy group, told the Associated Press that a strongly written press release is no substitute for true justice. This cannot be yet another immaculate fine where the government alleges widespread fraud and yet no individual is responsible. And as I said, also, the amount doesn't even really cover what they actually took, so...
Wow.
Who knows, you know, but that's what, they chalk it up and they report it as this is a victory for the people. You know, one of the banks has been held accountable, $470 million. And when I shared this article out after it was posted, most of the comments were like, they make that in a couple hours. They make that in a couple of days. They're not worried about, you know, just people, some people do get that, wow, that, you know, this is a gigantic international, multinational bank that is moving all kinds of money around. $470 million probably doesn't.
Well, all they had to do, how much is it?
$470 million.
So really all they had to loan out was 4.7 to print it, so why would they care? Oh, wait, this isn't an American bank. But I don't, you know.
But they're definitely stationed
in They probably have fiat currency that they're using there. I don't know what their arrangement with their government is, but, you know. Anyway, hey, I did see some other interesting European bank news, by the way. You know, in the MarketWatch, the headline is basically, why a sell-off in European banks is ominous. So at the same time you have that going on, you got different things. Basically, Europe's bank index has posted its longest weekly string of losses since 2008, and the banks have been caught in a perfect storm of market turmoil lately. Lackluster profits and negative interest rates. Basically, investors are dumping shares of the sector, and... So,
yeah, there definitely has been some interesting things going on in the international scene. Of course, we've talked about for the past couple months, and everyone's been seeing, although the media has kind of backed off, and now they're focused on the elections. But for a while, you know, it was, and it's still going on, the conflict in Syria and the back and forth between Russia and the United States that seems to keep taking place. But also what we're seeing is a tightening up of partnerships. You know, we just discussed the TPP, right? Well, that's involving certain 12 nations and some of the largest portions of the world's economy. But you may have noticed that China was absent from that deal. Russia was absent from that deal. Syria, Russia, a lot of
Brazil.
Brazil, India. A lot of these bigger partners. So they have, you know, there's the BRICS countries, nations that are forming their partnerships. And we also have this was just reported that Iran is no longer going to be accepting dollars for oil and is now asking for euros instead.
Yeah, I saw that.
And that's a big move. You know, this is what some people have predicted and seen for quite a while, is that as the U.S.'s hegemony through military intervention and just controlling by having the petrodollar is starting to shift away as these other nations are kind of making their power plays and partnering together.
Rather than worrying about that, we're going to spend more money in Eastern Europe.
That's probably why the people in charge of this country are pushing for 400% increase in military defense, is because they're anticipating that their empire is not as strong and people are having less.
And it's a reaction based on fear, you know, rather than a motivation of dealing with the economic issue at hand.
So, I mean, and if you look at
if the economics are all based on force anyway, well, it's a house of cards, period.
Exactly. And then if you also understand, you know, how empires crumble, that once they military adventurism and you know, also just, I think the United States officials and leadership could be too overconfident of their power and like overextending themselves now, and you have certain, obviously Russia and China, who exert their own influence, and other nations now, especially in Latin America, South America, starting to be like, we don't want to work with the United States. We're not going to let them come
in. It's a big world.
Take over our country for resources.
And why should we care?
You know?
Why should the average American citizen that cares about civil liberties and making money and having a good life really care if Chile doesn't want to work with, you know, this... with Exxon? Why should we care, you know?
Well,
they'll keep giving you reasons like, oh, you know, you're going to pay more at the pump and stuff like that. Really? Maybe we would find other methods instead of being stuck on just these.
Yeah, exactly. We might be forced to, you know, accept new models and to drill
for oil in Texas.
To look for alternative sources of oil or for energy.
Whatever, you know, just hopefully better.
Basically just push ourselves to other methods and, yeah, hopefully better methods. And that, you know, also just the reason that this has relevance, we're sitting here talking about the Iranian situation, is because if you understand the petrodollar, then you understand how interlocked oil prices and oil and the U.S. dollar as a world reserve currency, and how important that is. And so if the world starts deciding they don't want to deal in dollars anymore and they're going to make, you know, oil deals or whatever
gold-based
deals
dinars.
Using, you know, yeah, other, you know, maybe like something Libya tried to do or some of these other nations that have tried to do that curiously end up finding themselves a victim of the U.S.'s spreading democracy. You know, maybe this could be a shift of power away. And I honestly believe that those, I mean, I'm 30 years old, and so in my lifetime, in all of my life, the U.S. has been this superpower, and I think most of our lives, it's been that way for quite some time now, but I think it's a realistic situation to imagine that we could come to a point in our lives where the U.S. is no longer the global top power and...
overextended, broke.
and that sort of American-centric thinking of, you know, we're the world, you know, there's like... That pervades some people. I think that could really disappear where we see changing landscape.
I think it's part of the fact that whatever is strong in growing a nation in a lot of ways has been seemed to have been abandoned in, you know, the thinking and the culture of our leadership, or if you want to call them that. But, you know, as far as they are guiding the government of this country. So, you know, as they don't care about going in debt, of course, the people get, you know, the government they deserve. They go in debt. The government goes in debt. And what's debt? But slavery, you know. I mean, goodness. So at this point, you know, however, what do they think they say? I forgot how many tens of thousands of dollars they try to obligate each American citizen for. Forget that. But, you know, I mean, how far can this go? Of course, you know, it's not hidden. I mean, you know, we're not behind an iron curtain. Everybody knows what's going on. And so, yeah, people lose respect. If you're like, oh, that's my neighbor. Oh, God, they're so far in debt. They're not going to be able to pay for that. And blah, blah, blah. And they're going to be over here trying to bum oil from us. And if they don't like it, they get all ornery and topple our leadership, you know? And that's like, it's redundant after a while. I saw a thing that said, you know, and maybe I'll dig this article out later, but it said, Libya's invasion was so successful, expect another one. So I think that kind of sums up some of that.
Well,
actually goes into detail about how, you know, you can plan for their second.
They're already planning to go back in there to continue. Now it's like we got, oh, well, we had to go in there to get rid of Gaddafi, and now that created a mess. Now we had to go back in there to get ISIS out, and more intervention, more U.S. Troops. Well, if not troops, excuse me, drones.
There's one thing I thought was kind of interesting. Total side note. The San Antonio newspaper has decided to announce its plans to publish the names and addresses of every San Antonio police officer. What do you think about that?
That's insane. Say it again. That's kind of
That's out of left field, right? Well, basically, a Texas newspaper has decided to publish the names of names and addresses of every San Antonio police officer. Is this how it occurs after there was a deadly officer-involved shooting last week? So it turns out that the publisher of the San Antonio Observer says that Antrone Scott had been unjustly murdered. And Fox San Antonio reports this story, basically. It described Scott as being in a position of surrender when he was shot and killed on February 4th by a 10-year veteran of the force. So they say, you know, basically that this is a response. That's something that newspaper, that company that, you know, that is doing. They say just as the names and addresses of sex offenders are publicized in order to protect the public from their wicked behavior, we feel that our community has the right to the exact same level of protection. And this is interesting to me because this is something I've thought of before, you know, in different ways, like the effects of it. What would the information like that being out there be like? You know, as far as kind of like a check and balance. But
that's definitely, I think, you know, people talk about, like, on the internet, it's called doxing. You know, you're releasing somebody's information and all their pertinent details, and definitely has in the age of the internet with, I mean, in some really extreme ways, it's bullying people through, like, just if you want to get back at somebody, you know, it's not that hard to find people's details and to publish them and cause people some problem. People will deliver unwanted pizzas to your house or all kinds of different things, or, you know, possible violent threats. You know, you never know what level people would go to, but I feel like in a free society and in a way where people could reclaim more of their own power, that sometimes exposing people, and not to collectivize all police as one type of person, because I think that's a problem as well, but if they're, like they said, whether it's a sex offender or a violent person or an abusive person, whether they wear the, you know, the costume of post office worker or police or accountant, you know, it might be important to alert other people in that community that, hey, so-and-so lives here and this is what they've done or guilty of, you know, be aware, you know.
Yeah, I mean, it's a natural thing, even if it's not the best, it's natural that people, you know, if you're in a group of people that all know each other well and a new person comes in and you know something happened man, ain't no time for everybody knows that happened. Am I wrong or am I right? I mean, come on. It's just a natural thing. And so, but yeah, that's one of those things. I think it's a matter of degree with publishing that information. And since it's something I'd thought about before, I kind of was happy to have the opportunity to ask y'all what you think about it. If you want to weigh in, 713-526-8737. If you want to talk about doxing people.
Yeah. What do you think about that? You know, is it moral to give away police officers' addresses and to publish them? I think that there's a...
Is it immoral?
Not promoting violence.
Is it immoral to fail to?
Yeah, to fail to provide that information. Before we go to another song, it's funny to me. This is trending, at least on my version of Facebook. It says, police warn drivers on I-35 about rock throwers.
Man, that's kind of messed up, man.
Yeah, screw you if you're a rock thrower. Scary. It says over 60 rock throwing attacks have been reported on Interstate 35 in Austin, Texas.
That's some stupid
game. The fact that there hasn't been a death, I think we are just lucky at this point, says Assistant Chief McElvain. This kind of crime is extremely serious. We take it seriously.
See, I mean, I don't know what to say about this, but see, that's one of those things where what are you going to do? I mean, if you see someone on you read this story, you hear about all these deaths, you're driving up there, you see, you don't want to categorize all people, you see a rock thrower. A fool on the side of the road or on one of those overpasses trying to throw a boulder at your car that you're riding in. What do you do?
I think that, you know, if this was my community, and especially Austin's not a very big place, 35 is right through town, and they're saying late at night people have been going up there and throwing it, they're advising people to drive on the outside lanes to watch out for... I mean, that's all they can do is tell them to watch out. I mean, I'm hoping they're doing more than that, but I would be like, okay, well, I have family, I have friends, we all drive here, let's go to I-35, let's go see where these reports have been coming, and go there and see if we can find any rock throwers and talk to them and see what the heck's going on, and, you know, that would be my approach, is to try to go figure the situation out firsthand. Yes. Maybe not the...
Certainly needs to stop. It's really, I can't see any gain for anybody out of it. Some sick thrill, I guess.
Yeah, so, yeah, I definitely can say that in my life I've done some stupid things. I've never thrown rocks over bridges at people. I've definitely heard horror stories of things like that happening, but done some things that I feel like, oh, man, well, I was just being a jerk, or just, you know, getting my giggles out of messing with other people. And, you know, now I'm like, oh, God, what was I doing when I think about some of that stuff? But, yeah, stop throwing rocks.
Yeah, stop throwing rocks. Hey, and I know the cold weather is here and has been here. And it's just a little thing I wanted to mention. You know, make sure y'all are safe with those heaters, because I read in a couple of different Houston sources some deaths related to household fires in the suburbs here. So y'all be real safe, staying warm. Oh, man. But, you know, did you see that thing? I saw it out there from basically that the hack of FBI and DHS, and FBI, the feds are probing the apparent breach of FBI DHS worker data. They basically 20,000 apparent FBI employees and over 9,000 DHS employees. This hack was reported first on Vice's motherboard. The report said the hacker plans to release this information about the, speaking of docs, you know, 9,000 apparent DHS employees and 20,000 FBI employees. You know, this is a place that's supposed to keep us safe, right? You know, the DHS and the FBI and all these things, but, you know, who knows? Their data's being hacked. Oh, goodness. Yeah. So, you know, they're checking into that and investigating it to see if it's really going to happen or not, if this information has been hacked.
Absolutely. We're going to go to another song here. This is from Irie Samurai, new artist. Possibly, maybe coming for the community. We'll just check this out and find out, I guess.
Good music. Good.
But check it out. We'll be back here on KPFT Houston in just a few moments. You're listening to Freethinker Radio. And if you want to call in when we get back, start thinking of your questions. What's on your mind? 713-526-8737. We're here for another 30 minutes or so. Enjoy the music. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. My name is Derrick Broze, and you're here with me and Micah Jackson.
Yeah, that was Modern Explorations. We've been playing them. I'm all over the place. We've been playing them because we really love them, and we want to find more music we love. So send that stuff to us. We want to play music. We're not asking you to do anything. Never mind. Don't send us the music you love. Never mind. You know, we can't really say that. But, hey, if you want to, go ahead, because we love music and we want to share it with the world.
If you want to share music, we like to share music.
Yep, yep, yep. Got all kinds of news going on. And
I've got one right here.
Pretty excited about For the Community. We were just talking about it. I've been digging
this. We're talking off air about For the Community and how big of an awesome festival, celebration of life, music, and free expression, how great it's going to be. So we hope that you guys will check that out. Search For the Community 11 if you're on Facebook, or go to visionarynoise.com. Stay tuned for more details. This story here is actually just sort of an op-ed that I actually wrote, and it's just some details about police body cameras and why I think maybe we should have a critical eye when discussing the body cameras as a solution to police violence and to police abuse and misuse of power. So it says, in the last 2 years, the United States has seen a much-needed resurgence of discussion on police violence and abuse of power. The internet, cell phone cameras, and various apps have made it very easy to cop watch and to catch corruption on camera. There are millions of videos online, of course, that depict unnecessary police aggression and sometimes outright murder. And now that we're having this discussion, more people have recognized that we have a police militarization problem as well, that we have the federal 1033 program that funnels military weapons and equipment to your local police department, Houston for sure, and wherever you are, likely. And, you know, in response to this, we see the idea of body camera programs being floated, this vision of having officers wear cameras in the same way that, you know, dashboard cameras have helped people. The idea is, if you put a camera on an officer and videotape interactions between him and civilians, then it makes both parties safer, makes the officers more responsive and less likely to be crazy. Statistically, we're not sure yet, because these programs are all pretty relatively new. Obviously, the fact that we have millions of videos of people being abused by police on camera, and so, as I said, sometimes murdered on camera, often in cases where the police know and are perfectly aware that they're being filmed, the cameras didn't stop anything from happening that time. So I basically asked the question, and I'd like to hear your thoughts, 713-526-8737. Will police body cameras actually reduce violence, if implemented? Some of the programs, also the problems of the programs, is that the cities that have started to roll out the body camera programs, somehow they seem to accidentally turn off, or the officers purposely turn them off during various incidents. And it seems that if the police can turn the cameras off without insight, without literally any oversight, then there's no reason to really believe that they're going to use them in any sort of just manner, if they can just turn them off whenever they feel like it. I think that really, if we're going to solve that problem as far as body cameras go and the storage of that information, the people should have access to that. And we've talked about this. I know there's at least a couple of cities who've taken the program and they've done it like this, where the cameras are recording and there's a way to turn them off, like when the officer goes to the restroom or something like that. But other than that, when they're on duty and interacting with other people, the camera is rolling and it streams to a third-party service where the police can't delete it. They don't have access. Do they have access to it? But so does the public. So you could go there and look up the officer's badge name or time of incident or whatever. You know, you find an incident report or something, and you can go there and just search all these various streams and find the video of what happened between you and the officer. And so they have no way to delete that. You could even get a copy of it. Now, if that program was implemented here in Houston or elsewhere, I think that's something that could, you know, really be positive. But there's also this other disturbing point that I was recently made aware of by the American Civil Liberties Union. The ACLU discusses a recent article from the Washington Post that described how police in Fresno, California have a real-time crime center which issued threat scores for citizens based on a number of factors. The ACLU writes, "But one other part of Fresno's vision for the center caught my eye. According to the Post, the city hopes to add 400 more streams from cameras worn on officers' bodies. The ACLU says body camera video should not be used in systems that live stream video to centralized monitoring stations and allow police management to activate and monitor any given officer's camera at will. This is not the right balance between privacy and oversight and practicality. Body cameras are there to provide evidence and accountability in disputed circumstances, not to help furnish police departments with an all-seeing view of American cities and towns. So that was just a whole other area that I never even thought about. Like, oh, wow, all of a sudden they got all these cops with cameras on them, and they have these real-time crime centers, these little bases that they have in Fresno, and they have one in Houston. This is part of my open records request. I filed on the real-time crime center to see what I could find out there. But they've got a station with wall-to-wall cameras where they're paying attention to those 1,000 cameras around downtown that have been provided by the DHS. They've got access to their Stingray equipment. They've got access to the license plate reader database. And likely they're also using this threat score system that evaluates everything from your social media profile to your history, your crime history, everything like that, to issue you a certain threat, whether you're green, yellow, or red, depending on your possible threat to the police or to the government in their eyes. And now they're going to add to that body cameras worn by police officers around the city that they could just activate and watch at any point in time. Now that to me is just a whole nother level of surveillance that I didn't even think about before that. What do you think about that, Micah?
Room instead of everybody being able to do it, or
body cameras itself, and also just this idea that, I guess to me, it just seems really radical, the idea of all the cops walking around. Obviously, I mean, I guess it should have been assumed the cops are walking around wearing cameras, that somebody's going to be able to turn those on and take that footage.
Yeah, yeah.
But they will be, rather than just being streamed to some database that, nobody's really watching, this would be literally like you can go to live stream and watch different, you can watch live TV, right? But you have 100 different live streams of an officer depending on where they're at. Oh, here he's in Montrose. Oh, this one's over here. And I mean, I feel like that's just another set of cameras that
it's a twist, right? It's like every unintended consequences, right? They'll argue, and you can make arguments, that can almost convince an anarchist to tax people to put a camera on someone, because they think that's going to stop the brutality and the, horrific stuff that we do know has been documented that different individual police officers have perpetrated. But at the same time, you get, in a sense, something that they might find repugnant in like this Orwellian surveillance state sort of thing. So it's an interesting issue because it pulls this type of stuff up, and that's one of the most fun things about talking about the news is doing this, unraveling the extra stories in the stories. So I don't know, what are you going to say? Officers can already walk around anywhere public, right? I mean, why shouldn't they be, okay. So if a cop's already walking around anywhere public, what's the problem here? What's the problem with collecting this information? Call in at 713-526-8737. Let me know. What's the problem with them doing this, other than that one elite group get to see it when they take everybody's money to gather it? So I think, maybe if...
The monopoly, really.
Yeah, maybe if we can all just tune in to, the network there where the officers are walking around. It'd be like a Google Maps, where you go and look at the street and you can see the building and everything. You just go on and click, and then you'd see this officer walking down Main Street or this, and it'd be there forever. So when there's officer involved shootings and stuff, you see there's like these positive arguments that can be made for it.
Yeah.
But at the same time, why is it something that we're concerned about? I want to hear that question articulated. Why are we concerned about officers walking with body cameras around, filming things, and having this all sent to one central repository? If you can phrase that in a question, please do, because I want that articulated.
Yeah, absolutely. I could say, speak for myself and say that, my concerns, like you said, it's technology, right? And it's a tool that could be applied. I can think of some creative ways that we could. Let's say there's a civilian, a private alternative to Google, right? A community alternative to Google. And we decide we want to map our community, right? And imagine there's no Google Maps. We're like, okay, well, each of us, let's go walk around the neighborhood wearing cameras. And we'll just look at all the houses and all the streets, and we use those cameras in a way that's creative to create our own community map, right? So there you are taking cameras, the same thing, a body camera that the police would use that we're afraid of or worried about how they're going to use it, to apply it in a way that allows the community to grow and to prosper, right? So obviously that technology is just technology. It's a tool that can be used in any different way. The problem for me comes along when, as Micah said, that institution, the police, the government, has a monopoly on, you know, on force and on violence. And, you know, if you come and beat me up and abuse me, you're going to go to jail more than likely. But if the police do it, they often get away with it, or at the least they'll be assumed innocent before being locked up, and they'll get all sorts of protections that you or I wouldn't get. So to me, it's that the one rule for them, one rule for us. That's the problem. And when it comes to the police body camera situation, I feel like the same thing would be applied, that all of a sudden, yes, you're in public, and when you're in public now, you might as well assume you're being filmed. And yes, you know, we have every right to film the same officers in public as well.
Yeah.
But when you put it together that they don't only have access to all these officers' cameras, then they have access to 1,000 cameras around downtown that you and I don't have access to. So they form this part of this Big Brother system, this panopticon that we talk about often. And to me, it just becomes a big part.
And you just obey, like, the law because you're being watched constantly, rather than that the law is moral. Something like that?
Well, yeah, some would argue that it could change individuals' behavior, where people start to become less expressive or less free or less worried about freedom of expression, or just less likely to be themselves, like in 1984, because you never know. You know they're watching, but you don't know if they're always listening or when exactly they're watching, but you're just aware that the eyes are always on you, type of thinking. And some would say that, again, that in our evolving culture, that privacy
culture
is becoming less of a reality, or even a desire by some people, because of the surveillance culture's problem. And not only because surveillance from private or corporate or government entities, but also the fact that a lot of generations growing up today are used to putting everything on YouTube or Snapchat or Facebook or whatever. So to them, it's like, it's all out there anyways. It's not really kind of anything they're worried about keeping private, you know, because I think that there's maybe some,
I guess there's a line with private. We want to say something about the word intimacy. You know, I mean, isn't that the point, that there's some things that we would want to say are intimate, personal?
Yeah, absolutely. There's some things that people might feel are, you know, shared between individuals privately.
There's all kinds of things that can be this way, you know, obvious ones, romantic things, etc. But also other things, such as maybe you have a child with a disability that isn't one that is apparent. Okay, it's not out there where everyone can see it, you know, like walking on crutches, missing something, you know, these sad cases. But just something a little bit more that people might ridicule, you know. I don't know, maybe you gotta take them to get this sort of therapy, and maybe you don't want everybody knowing that, you know, because it creates this doxing of the child, you know, and this undue attention to a minor facet of an individual's life that can become, you know, quite embarrassing. But does it mean anything right and wrong wise? No, it's just someone feels horrible, you know? So, yeah, I think there's that point. But what is then the thing is, okay, so if we can all accept that there's certain things that are intimate, the minute you accept that, then there's a certain point that we have a right to privacy.
Yeah, exactly. And if you have anything to add to that, call in 713-526-8737.
Faux show.
Got just a couple more stories, and we're out of here for today. And I guess we're going to be closing today, just to kind of give you a preview, with Photon Mechanics, who will be playing at For the Community 11, March 18th and 19th.
For sure. I got some interesting stories if you want me to hit a couple of them
real quick.
We've been talking about banks. We talked about Norway's largest bank moving to a cashless society, trying to different things like that. Right now, that's in The Guardian. This headline comes from that in Germany, they plan to impose a limit on cash transactions. And this plan has been met with, like, fierce resistance.
Mm-hmm.
Proposals to ban. They basically wanted to ban payments of over 5,000 euros and 79. And the funny thing is, in Germany, 79% of the transactions are in cash. Goodness to Germany for that. That's kind of interesting. Cash has its problems, but it is at least a bearer item. So.
I've seen several stories in the past couple weeks talking about various countries and states, etc., starting to have what some people are calling, you know, the war on cash or whatever, moving towards digital currency. And yeah, there are you say cash can be used for smuggling, it can be used for illegal activity, but I definitely, again, privacy. I appreciate the value of having, like, being able to make an exchange with somebody, and we exchange two pieces of paper that we agree has a certain value.
Well, see, in our country, it's already illegal for you to really not report things, and mm-hmm. that's how the gangster keeps control of everything, because they got the hand in everything.
You better guess again.
Yeah, so, you know, remember that, and anytime you can use cash, go to a farmer's market, go to, you know, somewhere that you can, and pay people in cash as much as you can. It's really, it does something, and it's powerful. And, you know, yes, it's meaningless paper. It doesn't have any inherent value any longer, except for the fact that it can keep that exchange anonymous. And that's only for a limited time.
Yep, definitely.
So, you know, barters, alternative exchange networks, stuff like that are one way of dealing with a if cashless society is your concern. And, you know, yeah, I would use digital currency, but I wouldn't use it for everything, because maybe I don't want everybody knowing everything I buy.
Yeah, and I would say, though, you know, also considering ideas like cryptocurrency, like Bitcoin and others, those will allow you to use, quote-unquote, you know, digital currency, but with certain measures could be more private than, you know, your typical bank or credit card, whatever.
For sure, because after a while, you know, they don't...
That's like digital cash, almost.
Because everything they see you buy with your debit or whatever, you're getting all these ads for it. You're getting all this stuff. And you know, it also, you know, it tends to disempower smaller locations. But I will, you know, there's lots of little things now, like, I guess, the Square card, where you can use them at smaller markets. But I'm looking forward to the digital alternative currencies, the ones that are more anonymous, or whatever you want to call it. Liquid would be the right word. that they have little readers so that you can do it, you know, like at point of exchange. That'd be an interesting technology. I know it's been a year or so now that we've had a Bitcoin ATM, right, here in Houston?
Yeah, Houston has a Bitcoin ATM downtown at the George R. Brown Convention Center.
Well, I'm going to be quiet, because other than China harvesting organs...
That's the same one. I'm like, that's the same one I have, but I'm thinking that would be better suited for next week when we get more time.
Tune in next week for organ harvesting, more music, and other stuff. But yeah, we are winding down now.
Other little thing I want to throw out here, and yeah, please do. We've got 3 minutes or so left before we check out for the day. But one I wanted to throw out, this is just something I came across, somebody shared with me, for those of you who are into researching, you know, random things and the deep state of the government. Look up Janet Airline, exactly the way it sounds.
Yeah.
Janet Airline. Janet is the de facto name for a small fleet of passenger aircraft operated by the United States Air Force. Their aircraft transport military and contract employees and currently serve mostly the Nevada National Security Site, which includes Area 51, from their terminal at Las Vegas' McCarran International Airport. In common parlance, Janet is said to stand for just another non-existent terminal. And it says, due to the secretive nature of the airline, little is known about its organization. It's operated for the U.S. Air Force by infrastructure and defense contractor AECOM, through AECOM acquisition in 2014 of URS Corporation, a bunch of just, you know, no-name corporations. It'd be interesting to look more into them. But it says, for example, in 2010, URS announced it would be hiring Boeing 737 flight attendants to be based in Las Vegas, requiring applicants to undergo a single-scope background investigation in order to obtain a top-secret security clearance. Yeah, so this is just interesting little part of, you know, this one flight, unmarked airliner, that they have some pictures of the planes, but, you know, we don't know where they go. They have their own private terminal, taking people to Area 51 and other private government facilities. Pretty interesting stuff. And one last thing just to leave you with. This one is called How to Build a Solar Food Dehydrator for $300 and Preserve 10 pounds of food at a time. It talks about preserving food, canning, pickling, freezing. But it says, add dehydration to the mix to give you even more diversity. Instead of spending lots of money on a fancy machine, you can make a solar food dehydrator for much less and take pride in your DIY project, which is pretty cool. With a few tools and basic woodworking skills, this solar food dehydrator can become a vital part of your homestead. And it gives a little basic design on how to build this this equipment here, all the materials that you will need, the tools that you would need. And it might be a fun Skillshare for you to do with you yourself or your community, or if you want to learn how to dehydrate food and you don't want to go out and spend a lot of money, or just you want to do it the DIY way using the sun and some simple tools and equipment, check this out. We will share this on the Freethinker Radio Facebook page right now. And, of course, it'll be in the show notes on our archives and on the Houston Freethinkers Facebook page as well. So
thank you to everybody that shares any of that information with other people or invites people that they know would like the information we're talking about. I know you got a friend that would dig Freethinker Radio, man. Take a minute on Facebook page, invite them. That way, you know, you don't have to do it again and again. Just do it one time, share the page, do something, because we're really doing everything we can to share our community with y'all, with the whole world, and please share that YouTube video at the as well. That'll come out on the page. Thanks again for everybody tuning in. Thanks to KPFT for keeping us alive and out in the world.
Talk to you guys soon. We'll be here next Monday, same time, 3 p.m. Central, every week. As always, if you can hear this, you are the resistance.
Live free, think free, and you will be free.
Peace.
I'm using logic, blessed with the gift. Spocks on the clock with the vocal concepts. Got chefs in the kitchen, beats getting cut. Ripping stuff up, other MCs can't touch. With the glove and I'm stepping in the club, I got some holes in my chucks. Pearl snap shut, got